going around the table. What are your names, position, and responsibilities at the university?
My name is Joe Gray. I'm a lecturer here at the University of Wisconsin-Platteville. I primarily teach the CNC machining class.
I'm Kyle Meslov. I teach, I'm kind of, I head up the metals area, you'd say, this metals minor area, industrial studies. And I teach the metallurgy and used to teach all the machining classes. And I teach also metal casting.
Hi, my name is Eric Rimo. I'm an assistant professor here at UW-Platteville. I teach kind of all over the place. I teach the woods classes. I also teach the metals classes, but I guess my main concentration is in the 3D solids modeling, drafting, and product development.
Either one of you, could you tell us about the industrial studies department, specifically the metals?
The goal of the industrial studies department is to produce students that go out in industry and are really good at problem solving. Typically, the students that come to our school that are really hands-on oriented and they go into mechanical engineering or something like that, they kind of get a little bit bored because they're not using their hands enough. And our program is 50% hands-on, 50% theory. So it's resides somewhere between a two-year program and an engineering degree. So the industry likes the students come out of our program because they hit the ground running and they have a lot of hands-on background. Mechanical aptitude is really the important thing. So they go out in industry and are very successful usually. Management is another area where the students get some experience and some coursework where they can work on the hard part of manufacturing is actually the people skills as well as the technical. That's sometimes an area where not all students graduating from an engineering program might get.
So you mentioned you had four PC&C 770s. What accessories did you buy with the mill, and why those specific ones?
We kind of got a range of accessories. We got all four of them with the power draw bars. We saw the value in that, and we definitely do not regret that. Just being able to pump the tools in and out. Then we did get the automatic tool changer, got the fourth axis hooked up on it. That's kind of our, if we're going to run production type operations on the Tormach, we'll do that there. We occasionally run into those operations. Usually we're more of a pattern or tooling type deal where it's one-offs, or we're just using it for educational purposes to make widgets to get students competent in different areas. But along with the fourth axis, we got different accessories that build onto it to make it easier to make something interchangeable. We used our other mills to make tooling for it, so that we can actually use that to make tooling for other stuff. And we made a vacuum plate specifically for the Tormachs, so we can do a lot of signage. Actually, that's someone's project this semester, is to make a generic thank you plaque that says, thank you, or from UW-Platteville, thank you for your donation of blank from this company for some recognition.
Last time we visited you guys, you talked about the day they were delivered.
I said, you know, today's a snow day, and there's a bunch of students that showed up saying, do we have class today? Or, well, let's. So I texted a bunch of students that came in, and there was about 8 or 10 students came in.
We have a time-lapse video. It's kind of funny to watch because the first 4 hours, just open the boxes, seeing what's there. Got one set up, and it was within an hour and 50 minutes. We had all four on their pedestals, bolted together, nearly ready to go. And actually, the snow day was nice because we could just do an entire day of
lifting. Yeah, no one was bothering us.
No one was bothering us. After that, it was like, okay, I got to go teach class.
A single semester, which is what, 3 months?
3 months?
Yeah. They were delivered, figured out, and they were
incorporated into the
curriculum, and we were making patterns for things. So,
we made the Taliesin pattern.
That's big stuff. I mean, to go from a big blank space to students actually learning.
Traditionally, we're trying to take 3 or 4 semesters, or even a 2-year program, mm-hmm. cram it into a semester, trying to get them a little bit of just understanding what CNC machine parts are. You know, why would you have a ball screw? that type of thing. And last semester we had two classes of five groups of 10 groups, and we had 10 projects that were made, and I believe seven of them were done on the Tormachs, along with a whole bunch of other random parts that students just wanted to work on because they like four-wheeler parts or you know, little coasters or whatever. It's something where I don't have a problem saying, hey, you've gone through the CNC class, go hop on a Tormach and do something. You can get 10 grand spindle speed for that fine engraving detail, and I can just let them go. They can learn the most, maybe not the most efficient way, but a very constructive way, and that's making their own mistakes and learning from them. And that's so valuable for them. In the Tormachs, I mean, it's very easy to open up the code, edit it, go right back to where you're running, hop right into it. On our other machines, you have to change, edit, exit, save, go over to the verify screen, load it, run it, maybe at the right tool, possibly, maybe not, depending on how it's feeling that day. And then, okay, it didn't work, go back to the program. It takes just twice, or not even twice, three or four times as long to do the basic problem solving stuff.
When you're looking to buy the mills, what was your deciding factor on why you went with Tormach?
I think flexibility and size. Our lab is cramped, and there's no way we could put four larger machines in. Plus, we don't have funding for four larger machines.
Yeah, I'd say cost and size. Yeah. We're kind of on the same plane.
And just the ability to plug and play. You just plug them into 110 and go.
When I was a student in Kyle's class, with one machine, and with the high horsepower machine, a lot of risk involved.
It's
basically, he was standing there while all the students and their groups went through, and I mean, easily three or four lab periods just to get through.
Six groups, probably at least an hour per group, per lab, and probably two times that, because they would come in, it wouldn't work, and so they'd have to go back and rewrite, and then come back, and that's another hour. So somewhere in that neighborhood of 12 hours a week, just standing there watching students try not to crash a machine.
And when you have a line of 10 people behind you who are waiting,
it's they can't think.
They can't. They have their notes in front of them, and you're standing over them, and you're making sure that they're not crashing the only machine that you've got, a large machine. It's a pressure cooker, and with four groups going and Joe able to walk around, they're actually interacting with each other. I mean, they're learning from each other. They're learning from Joe, but they're also learning from each other. We've never had that opportunity before, besides people standing in line behind going, well, I'm not going to make that mistake that he just made.
The service is great. The tooling's cheap, and it's effective. We're not talking about little flimsy machines that will break. These things will cut steel. We've cut steel. It works on it. So you're not going to match an Akuma process for processing speed, but that's not what we need, and that's not what you need in high school or college. Or we just need something that
garage. I student taught at a school in Pullman, Washington that had a Haas mill, but they couldn't use it because they couldn't afford the tooling for it. I mean, they got it; it sat there. Now they would have been better off with 10 of these than one of those. Their kids would have actually been able to use them. So, yeah, no, I would. Tech ed is my background. That's what I'm a tech ed teacher, technically, by trade. I could see Tormachs more in use. I would turn my back on a 16-year-old kid on a Tormach way before I would turn my back on a full-featured BMC. So, and you have to, because you have other kids over there.
Last time we were here, we visited your foundry, and we watched you guys cast a window hardware for a building restoration project. And Eric, I spoke with you about how the project went through all three of your classes.
Right.
Can you explain that to us?
It started with my class. It went to, I think, the casting class with some rough idea of shape, size, volume to determine castability, and then it went to the CNC class.
They machined the pattern, came to the foundry. The students ran simulations, used software to run simulations on how the metal is going to flow and how it's going to solidify, so we wouldn't either get a defects caused by either of those. And then a student in Joe's class machined the part, the patterns and the core box, and then our students cast some prototypes. They work, and then the following semester, the club, our AFS club, actually produced the actual castings over a number of weeks.
Yeah, there are 50 total.
Yeah,
that 50 we
total.
To make.
Yeah.
So, and each mold had one set apart. So
yeah.
That was 50 molds.
So 150 parts total.
Yeah.
Three parts per subassembly.
Yeah,
for main assembly.
So,
a lot of work.
There's a lot of work. We got a little bit of cleanup to do and assembly to do yet, but they're.
But nobody makes that part anymore, and that is a restoration project.
All right. Well, thank you for your time.
Okay. Thank you.